from Russia. Marsha was from Russia. Oh, your mom's there.
Good to see you guys here. She's a morning person. She's a man of her husband, I can tell. Well, you know what I think? It's a good day to praise God. What do you think? It's a good day to praise God.
Yeah, all right.
How many people are here today to give thanks and love and adoration to Jesus? How many people are glad they got through last week? How many people are here to get a little message of faith for this coming week? We need to give it up. We need to stand up and let it rise. What do you think? Does everyone agree? Clarkies, and it's been a little bit cold, but Well, we've been having a good time. Josh got sick out there yesterday, so he's home. I'm not sure right now if he's in bed or on the toilet. But anyway, not feeling well.
Overshare.
I thought I'd share. So if you get it on Facebook or something, ask him. So we got a few things coming up. Well, last but not least, we had two people, or not the least of which, asked about Trunk or Treat. Where is she? She asked me about it this morning. She's not here. Okay. Oh, I think she's back there doing slides. Pam, look. All right. How many people raise your hand if you bring their car to do Trunk or Treat? It's where you decorate your trunk. Raise them high. Raise them high. Talk to Pam because she doesn't have anyone doing it. So if we don't get more people, then we'll cancel. The kids in the neighborhood are going to miss out. We need some more cars, people. So, and it's a Halloween alternative, normally. Not really this time, but we're going to talk about that. I shared my dislike about that with Terry this week. But anyway, we're going to do Trunk or Treat, so we need to get more vehicles. Pray about it. All you do is you bring your car, you open your trunk, you decorate it, kind of fun, and you give out candy, and it's a good fellowship time. The kids in the neighborhood, I think, how many did we get last year? Then believe me, the kids are out getting candy. The year before we had several months. But anyway, Trunk or Treat, that's coming up. Mark the calendars. Ask me when it is, somebody. Hold on a minute. When? No, you're supposed to ask me when it is. It's October 24th from 3 o'clock till. Jeez, bless you people. One of the other things is, has anyone here been to an evening of worship and prayer at New Covenant? It is awesome. We get about 40 or 50 churches together, and here's what goes on. We get up there. Have you guys been to the back? Isn't it awesome? We have a good time. Jimmy used to do it. We all do it together. Pastors get up, read some scripture, and we pray for a certain area. We have pastors behind us with their hand on us praying for the pastors delivering them. Prayer. And that's going to be October 25th at 6 p.m. and it's at New Covenant. The worship team is led by a guy named Josh Meisner, who's a friend, been a friend of ours for many, many years. And it's one or two people from a lot of different churches that gather to sing. And let me tell you, it's pretty, pretty neat for them to get together. And it's a singer from about 19 different ministries. And we just get together in prayer and worship. Prayer for different areas of the city. I recommend that you go, especially if you haven't been, okay? November 14th will be the last Orange Track racing for the season. So, you guys remember that. Ray, you going this time?
I was there last time.
Are you going to be at this one, I mean?
Yeah.
Because I know when your schedule's been crazy lately.
If I can get my boss, give me the day off.
Right. And Thanksgiving dinner. Now listen up. We are going to be teaming up with St. Mark's to do a dinner here. We invite some neighborhood people. We're here, and that'll be Thanksgiving Day from 11 to 1. It says at the church, the neighborhood again this year. We'll be bringing food. I guess we'll TBA when we're bringing it. I would imagine by next Sunday. We were going to have it this Sunday, but due to what's happening. And always Tuesday morning. Where's Pete? Pete, are you still doing your 6 a.m. somewhere?
Yeah, sure.
McDonald's. I have McDonald's. Which one? On Edgewood?
Yes.
The one in front of the Hy-Vee?
Right.
All right. Pete does a 6 a.m. or 6:30. And then we have one at 8 at the Collins Road Hy-Vee. So we offer one at 6:30 at McDonald's in front of Hy-Vee on Edgewood. Then we have one at 8 for those that can't make the 6:30 at Hy-Vee. On Collins Road. 6:30 p.m. is the woman's book study here. And there's also an NA meeting, so make sure you do that. And then, of course, we always have our Bible studies here. You guys, make sure you mark your calendars. Get involved in some meet-and-read stuff and some pretty good stuff, okay? At this time, let's stand and greet each other in the Lord. Maybe try and meet somebody you haven't met. Just say hi.
Hello.
Good morning.
worship team appreciation. And two of them aren't here, so Leo, we wanted to thank you for being an assistant associate pastor and a worship team leader. And
yeah.
Thank you so much for all that.
Hold on, he wants to read.
It says, the love of Jesus shines through you. God knew that it would make a wonderful difference in the hearts and the lives of people. That is why he chose to use you. Thank you for all you do to shine through him. And that was what God foreknew that you would be here today seeking him. That's kind of what I'm seeing. Thank you so much.
Awesome.
Thank you.
God's good?
This is
just as we are. We come to love you. We come just as you are. We come just as we are broken. We're broken people, Lord. We come just as we are asking for your love. We come just as we are asking forgiveness. We come just as we are. Hello, my name is Addict. My name is broken. My name is not perfect. My name is trouble. My name is divorced. My name is separated. My name is angry, depressed, scared. My name is running. My name is manipulator. Hello, my name is defeat. Hello, my name is I'm tired. My name is all these things. Lord, fill me. Lord, let me just let all my I can do is go and turn my life over to you. Really turn my life to you and let you fill me. Lord, my prayer today is after this message that people can leave here better understanding you and filled with you, Lord. In Jesus' name we ask all of this. Amen.
This time,
we're going to have the guys come forward with the offering plates for tithings, which is the responsibility of the members of this church, and gift and offerings. So pray about what you can do. Come on, guys. Thank you.
Father God,
Chris and I said we'd be fighting over who we pray for what today.
But we're in your done.
So we will give a few-week notice, it'll probably run into our Advent season, but I think that's okay. What do you think?
Okay.
So we'll let you know. We'll figure out a date this week. Okay, fair enough?
Yes.
And we're going to show Do You Believe for free with free popcorn. Amen?
Amen.
So our subtitle this week is Do the Wrong Thing. How many people sometimes do the wrong thing? And we want to go back and rewind that, but it's like gone, and you're like, how many people say, do the wrong thing time after time after time? I'm not picking on anyone in material, you know what I'm saying? Sergeant James, can you separate a little bit? I'm not picking on anyone in material back there. But anyway, I'm not picking on anyone, Brad. But we do, and sometimes it takes, you know, it could be the first time or the tenth time when we get it right, amen? But how many people, when we do the wrong thing, have people telling you, I told you so?
Yeah.
You should listen, I know better. Okay, but those people that say, I told you so, what happens when they do the wrong thing? Well, you can't say that to them. They can say it to us, right? I told you so. But when you do that, what do they say? Yeah, but I had 10 weeks. You had extenuating circumstances, but I did. Okay, I got you. But here's the difference. How often do we find ourselves making those decisions? Well, guess what? You're certainly not alone. We all do. None of us are perfect. Maybe she is. I see slugs picking up perfect. I don't make mistakes. Yeah, I do. But we all make these decisions, and guess what? It's part of life, right? Amen?
Yeah.
We're going to make these decisions, and we make those decisions all sorts of reasons. Can you guys hear me okay? These monitors, what do they run?
What
do they run? I don't hear guitars, I don't hear vocals, I don't hear myself. Alright. Who's that that runs, huh? Some of these reasons, for our personal pride, sometimes for our personal gain to save friends' hides.
Excuse me.
Sometimes we fib to save people. The point is, we do the wrong thing, and that's not a good thing. And most of the time, it gets found out, and for whatever reason, we're the jerk, and it hardly ever works out. Get found out, and then it's for us. And then after, now these days, it's for us, let's get on Facebook and get them looking for sorry for us. Poor me. Can I be the victim and get everyone to get it liked on Facebook on my new time? Poor me. Quit playing the victim. I said to my wife, you'd have God over here going, what kind of Christian husband is that? Well, I don't want to be a Christian husband right now. You should be a Christian husband all the time. And you get all this stuff going on, you know? We make these decisions based on what's going on at the time instead of what we should be doing. How many of you let instead of letting God choose to help you respond? We were talking this morning in a Bible study about, you remember, back when What Would Jesus Do? WWJD was the cool thing, and then it got so commercialized it wasn't cool anymore. Because even non-Christians would wear all the stuff, and you'd walk up and say, what does that mean, WWJD? I don't know, it was cool. So it got so played out, it wasn't cool. Now, I'd say, well, we'd be cool to some people who represent, you know what I'm saying? But oftentimes, as Christians, changing, but good for you. I'll bet at some point in your life, you can identify with what I'm talking about. When it talks to you, certain things change in what you do, and not being focused on not letting situations change you. Do you know people that situations don't deter how they act? I do. I've been the same people. But do you find that those sort of people are usually steadfast on their course, or a little easy partner around the edges, a little rougher? Yes or no? Meaning they're not lackadaisical. I have an aunt and uncle who, when the kids were growing up, they had certain rules. They didn't bend. Never, ever wavered. They had their. And I thought, wow, that's pretty. Did you get that out of a textbook? I mean, they were that strict. Not strict like they couldn't do anything, but strict like they never bent their rules. Now me, that's my kids. I bent when I wanted to. There were my rules. I could bend them. Like I ground one of my daughters, but if they worked their butt off for a day, they knew they could get out of the ground. But I benefit. Why not? Well, then I went 3 or 4 years later. That was a bad thing to do because I'd get all this work done, but they weren't learning because they were still doing the behavior. So I learned rapidly that wasn't good. We're going to start today. If you get your Bible, go to chapter 7 of Romans. If you don't have a Bible, there's one in front of you. If you can't see one in front of you, look next to you. You still can't see one, tap someone next to you. What are you on it? Mom will slap me. Thank you. True son. All right, everyone got a Bible that wants one? Romans chapter 7, we're going to start in verse 21. Verse.
Don't do that.
Verse 21, please. I have discovered this principle of life, that when I want to do what is right, I inevitably do what is wrong. Verse 22 goes on to say, I love God's law with all my heart. But there's another power within me that is at war with my mind. This power makes me a slave to sin that is still within me. Oh, what a miserable person I am. Who will free me from this life that is dominated by sin and death? You see, Paul struggles too, so you're not alone. We're not alone. Remember, Paul had a thorn in his side, what, the old most of the time? He struggled. We all struggle. Jesus struggled. What was one of the last things he said? I hear a hum, babe. A bad hour. Someone tweaking the board.
It's
not me. It's not the vocals. I'm asking the vocals, please. So, Paul struggled as well, is my point. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8 says this, stay alert. Watch out for the great enemy. The enemy being the devil. Prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. What we're talking about here, people, when you stay still and think life's okay and think everything's going smooth so don't rock the boat, you're being fooled. There's nothing godly about that. Never stay still. Stay busy. Stay in the Word. What I mean by stay busy, stay in the Bible. I'm so tired of hearing from people, I don't have time. Guess what? Make time, you're going to fail, you're going to be attacked, and I don't want to hear about it. I know that sounds callous. I don't. Because when people come to me with their issues, and I say, well, I'm standing still, I don't possibly have. I don't want to hear about it. Because if you don't have time for God, what's the flip side of that? I can't hear you.
He doesn't have time for you.
Oh, really? What happens, Joe, if you call a friend? 6, 8, 10 times wanting to hang out, they tell you no. Are you gonna keep calling?
No.
What?
No.
Why?
You don't care.
Oh, who doesn't care?
You don't. that point, he's waiting for you. Amen? So when you people say, I don't have time, I can't do this, I can't serve, which is what you were created to do. I can't do that, I can't, I have this many jobs, I have that, and I have this, I have people. That's not what God wants you to do. I understand working a lot of jobs for finances. I do. Let's trade schedules for a week or two. For real. I get the hours. Trust me. Rick, how many hours did you do last week?
Over 70.
Yeah. Believe me, he gets it. We get it. You've got to make time for God, people. And that's not just skimming. You know, when I started doing devos 12 years ago, all right, Ron, my old boss, I'll do one, I'm here to go about my day. There, I did it. I couldn't tell you what I read. Do you know now when I do devos, and not only do I take the time to do them, it consumes me a little bit during the day. Because when I read them, I gotta investigate them a little bit. You know what I'm saying? What did I read? I gotta investigate it. What was he talking about? What was going on at that time? And it gives me sermon ideas. And I'll call Terry or Josh sometimes, who are my little accountability guys, and say, this is what I read, this is what I got. In fact, Josh and I are breaking down the book of Acts. The last two times we met, we have got to Acts because of stuff we've read during the week. Truthfully. It's amazing. People take time for God. We also talked this morning, and this has nothing to do with the sermon, it's the last thing I want to interject with is this. Start a prayer life if you don't really have one. And it can be arrow prayers. You know what arrow prayers are? Just throwing them out at the Lord. Help me get through my day at school. Lord, help me get through my day at home. Lord, help my mom and dad not be mad at me. Lord, help my kids understand. Lord, I don't feel well today. Help me get through. Day without being sick. Lord, my gas light, come on, help me get to it. They can be arrow prayers. And then learn to pray. Like, I'll give you for instance, my wife. No, this isn't a bad thing. I'm going to get it. She gets gas when her gas light comes on, but not when it first comes on. The other day in a new car, I'm like, baby, we got it. She knows. I tried. All my life, so all my history with her, baby, when you get down to a half a tank, it's empty, fill it up. She don't. She'll get that gas light on. I got 61 miles. Your gas light's on. I know my car. Every car she's had since I've known her, she can tell you how many miles when the light comes on. I'm like, baby, it's going to be 20 degrees, 20 minus up there. You're going to run out of gas. Not at all. Near as she goes, like, well, I can stay warm. I have the heater. Not if you're out of gas. She didn't tell you how many miles to get. For real. So then I went, I even broke my own thing all my life and said, okay, how about a quarter tank? You get down to a quarter, fill up. All right, baby, all right. I get back in the car. Baby, your lights on. I know I got 50 miles. I don't get it. My mom always taught me half a tank. One day I finally asked my mom, Mama, why is it half a tank? And she said, baby, you never know when you don't got any money. You gotta get out of town. That's horrible. But anyway, rule of thumb, order tank, fill up your tank. Everyone okay? How many people wait for gas lights?
Oh, no.
Are you, all of you?
Oh, no.
Oh, my God. Babe, you're a good company.
I don't see.
You know you're bad. Bad, bad, bad. I just had a panic attack. In Jesus, out the slacker delivers. Okay. So 1 Peter 5:8 says what? Stay alert. Watch out for the great enemy, the devil. He prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone. Okay, we're going to show a clip, but I want to give you a little up front. This clip is from the movie Do You Believe? Yes, Lord. Let me set this up a little bit. In this clip, JD and Terry, his wife, have been living in grief since the loss of their daughter 20 years prior.
She was killed in a car accident by a drunk driver, J.D., her dad. After hearing a sermon from his pastor about do you believe, decided it was time for a change and to move on. So Terry, his wife, wants to stay in the past. And in her grief, and still very angry with God over the loss of her daughter. But she's going to church the whole time, just filling the pew. And J.D. describes where God was, because the mom's opinion is, where was God when her daughter got killed? Can someone fill the lights, please?
Denny's getting up.
Oh,
never mind.
Somebody got up. Thank you.
What are you doing?
Something we should have done a long time ago.
Cut it back. What's the matter with you?
Terry, Kathleen is gone. She's not away at college or working in Minneapolis. She's not coming back for Christmas.
This is my daughter's room. This is all I have left.
This is not a room, sweetheart. It's a museum. We're not honoring her memory. We're living in the past.
What else are we supposed to do?
Terry, the world didn't end when she died.
Austin.
No, it didn't. We wanted it to, but it didn't. And ever since, we've been selfish. We've turned our grief into our most prized possession. God doesn't want that.
Where was God when I lost Kathleen?
I'll tell you where he was. He was asking that man not to take another drink, begging that bartender not to serve it to him. He was hoping he'd call a cab, call with a friend, anything to get behind that wheel. And when it was all over, he cried, just like we did.
Why are you doing this to me, people? Why now?
Sweetheart, you know how Matthew said that belief is an action? Well, it's time for us to act. We've got to get back up and start living again. I want to do more with the time I've got. There's a whole world of people out there who need help, who have no place to stay. And every time it rains, they sleep wet. And every time it's cold, they sleep cold.
You're turning our whole life upside down because of a sermon?
No. I've been thinking about this for a long time. That sermon has given me the courage to actually do something about it.
Yeah. It's on my heart to do it, to get them here, get them to know God, help them, assist them. We are looking for a van, if you find anyone that knows anyone, at least a 11, 12 passenger to get them here. We have got to reach this community. That's why we're here. We're not here for more veterans. We need to get here. We need to get out. This scene, he had heard his pastor preach a sermon after having an awakening called Do You Believe? Came home and said, we need action. We haven't been doing it. And we need to put our daughter to rest. We've gone 20 years. You see, people were quick to look for the absence of God like Terry did, the mom, instead of the presence of God like J.D. did, the dad. Amen? Amen?
Amen.
He saw where God probably was. Bad things happen.
problem is we just make it too difficult or complicated. We try to create solutions or answers on our own. Guys, God's not CSI. We need to let go and let God. I know it's cliche. Do you trust Him with all your heart, people? Ask yourself that question. Do you love Him? Do you want Him? More importantly, do you believe? The bottom line is, we don't look so hard to solutions. Don't look so hard for God. It's right here. It's right there. It's with you. Can I ask you a question? I heard this this week. You know, don't answer it, Leo. Do you know why ducks fly? You know how ducks fly in a V? You know, when they look out there in a V? You know why one line's longer than the other? You know why? Because there's more ducks in that line. That's how simple it is sometimes. We look for all the line. We look for all these hard answers, and it's that simple. Quit being CSI. Quit looking for all these things. Just pray and open your heart. God will come in your heart. We were talking about in Bible study this morning. You don't need this big epiphany and all these big things. I believe as a pastor, even in my heart of hearts, when I was dabbling, I called it Christ, and I had given my whole heart to Jesus, but I knew Jesus was there, but I kept fighting it. I really believe in my heart that the Holy Spirit was in me, because I felt the warmth sometimes and the neatness, and I knew He was directing me, but I kept fighting it. But I believe, even though I haven't given my whole heart wholeheartedly, that Jesus was in my heart, the Holy Spirit was in me. People, God loves you. God wants you. Wants a relationship. In 1 Peter 5:8, it told us, stay alert, watch out for the greatest enemy, right? Make no mistake, because He's waiting for you, the devil. One of the biggest obstacles here is escaping or letting go of your past. Did you hear that? The biggest obstacle in your life is releasing the past. You see, even when you let go, other people try to keep you there. That's the problem. Even when you're able to let go of the past, other people keep you in your past. First year I became a Christian. Now you remember, I came from working with the bands, touring for 10 years, living in Hollywood, California, moving to Vegas, having a club. And when I gave my life to Christ, most of my family was home. They're like, what in the? And most of my friends, they were all in the bands. Well, my uncle died, and one of the bands came to the funeral in Vegas. They're like, hey, Bartoli, because Chris Bartoli in Vegas. But I mean, I had the Goo Goo Dolls there, a lot of the guys from Boys with Jessa, Dio, and all of our band friends were there. I'm like, what do you got going on? I'm like, I'm so far. God had been working on my heart, all these things. And when I look back and turn my life over to Christ, I'm like, no. And my whole family shunned me a little bit. Shunned me. But God touched my heart. And it took years. Little by little, they started calling Pam and calling me to pray for them. And we asked your brother to pray for this, or call my other sister. We call your brother to pray. Call me right, bro. You don't have to go to the temple with your offering. Oh, what's going on? Or better yet, why don't you talk to God? You don't have to go through me. How about that? And now I'm seeing some of them come to Christ. Over a 14-year, 15-year period is amazing. So here's what we got to do. Don't let these people hold you back. I got to tell you now, and some people don't like to hear it, sometimes you got to change your playground. Sometimes you got to pick up your toys and bail. That's the hardest thing to do. Change playground. Change friends, some of them. And now in today's technology, get off of Facebook. Quit tweeting. Get off LinkedIn. Get off all that junk. Put your phone away. And I have a Bible app on it. Open a Bible.
We read in Romans chapter 7, the easiest bread to eat. Hear me. Don't read this right now. Hear this. The easiest bread to eat is the one standing still. Parking in the shadow of your past is the surest way to be caught standing still.
Amen.
Is that good? Standing still requires not having time for God. How many people want to stand still? Raise your hand. Oh, come on. Who wants to stand still? How many people are going to get the word this week? How many people are going to spend time with God this week? No, I'm not looking at you, baby. I'm looking behind you. I'm not pointing to it out this week. My wife said I do it too much. I'm going to read this again. The easiest prey to eat is the one standing still. Parking in the shadow of your past is the surest way to be caught standing still. I can't point you out this way. You need to embrace your present, people. Let go of the past, and more importantly, embrace your future. Make plans to get a better relationship. Now, this one you can look up if you want, or it might be on here. 2 Corinthians 5:17. This means that anyone who belongs to Christ has become a new person. Amen? The old one is gone, and the new life has begun. Do you know you can, every week, give everything when you're at church? Let go of last week and make plans for next week. That's what this is about here on Sunday. Sunday's not here. Oh, we came to church Sunday. We've done everything. This is just a plan next week. See, right? We're open every day. Come hang out. And then when you come up here for communion, let it all go. Get up here with your prayer warriors. Today it'll be Leo. No, maybe we'll change that. No, today it'll be the Bonifazes. They'll be up here. Bonifazes will be up here today praying. Come up, give a prayer. Because isn't it hard to release stuff sometimes, right? It's hard to let it go. More importantly, it's hard to share. When you share with another human being and you release it to God and you give prayer for it, there's nothing greater than prayer. Jamie just talked to Terry, by text and by call. Since last night, the first time in 4 days, his mother's heart rate's been absolutely broken.
Amen.
That's prayer. Nothing else. They can't, they don't know why medical. They put it in their past. Endless comfort. Thank you, Jesus. What's going on? God, that's what's going on. So even if it is to be God, right? She's doing the comfort. So really, your new life is already here, but the old you have to let go of. Let it go and embrace what's next, people. It's time to move on. Let go of the junk. Empty the trunk. Time to move on, but to move on with what? With God. It's like we always talk about. You always hear what? God never gives you more than you can handle. Untrue. God doesn't give you more than you can handle what? With Him. I'm going to say that and you can say it in Yiddish. I don't care. I want you to know that. You know why it's tough? Because Satan uses obvious temptations. Satan knows you. Like in that clip, what did he use? He used the guy drinking. Because sometimes he's more subtle. Like nailing Terry and JD to their past with their kid. That's how subtle he was. Defining moments don't always come in friendly form, right? Or in a friendly way. Sometimes the wrong thing seems like the right thing people are like. Like feeding the ducks for us, for the kids. When the lady told me it was illegal and I'm feeding them with my grandkids, we talked about that. And I felt bad, thought with integrity, I better not go feed the ducks there anymore, right? You know my wife said to them, can I share that?
I
You know my wife said, a pastor's wife? She said, I'm going to still take them. I think it's a stupid law. Do you know what I said to my wife? No, you're not. I think going 60 on the freeway is stupid, so I go 90. She goes, good point.
I said, just don't get caught on camera.
Okay, she's trying to be funny. That's not what she said. But the point of the matter is, if it's against the law, we're not doing it. Period. As stupid as I think the law is, we can't go break the law, right? Is that setting a good example, Christian? No. And it breaks my heart. We've been feeding the dust bell since I lived here in 01, 2000, or we moved. I did it with my kids. But integrity is important as a Christian. If we realize we've done the wrong thing with the defining moment, it's never too late to make a change. Feed the dust. So people, get out of the past. Living chained to the past is always the wrong thing for someone who believes in Jesus Christ. We need to remember that faith is Jesus in Jesus. Faith in Jesus requires action, movement, and response. Otherwise, remember, what is it? Just knowledge. It's just knowledge. That's it. You know what it reminds me of? What would E.T. call it? What would he call it? What would E.T. call it when he wanted more knowledge? Anybody? When he wanted more knowledge? Okay. Anyone else? Jamie, what would E.T. call it when he wanted more knowledge? Oh my God. I'm aging myself. All right, we need to take more action this week. Here's what we need to do. Ready? First, we need to confess. Do you know the Bible tells us that there's healing in confession? So find an accountability partner, everybody. I've been saying this for 2 years now until I'm blue in the face. She's tried with 3 or 4 people, Bill. I guess people here don't get that you need an accountability partner. I have 2. You got to have one, or the Christianity is going to work for you. If you don't have someone, pastor or an accountability partner that you can share your sins with and your thoughts and your healing with. I'm telling you, you're going to struggle with Christianity. Is there exceptions to the rule? Yes, just like everything else. It makes it a lot easier with an accountability partner. So find an accountability partner, a pastor, one of the pastoral staff, which we have, 5 of us now, and let go of the past. Share some of them. Or the sin that you're struggling with, or the issue that you keep hanging on to. They will counsel you with prayer and love and walk you through it. Or find a professional. Some people are seeking professionals, which is good. If you go to one of the staff or a professional and you're not making headway and it doesn't work, go to another one until you find your fit. Sometimes you don't, by the way. Don't go to a counselor or a pro or a non-pro or and say it's not working, it's just not for us. It might be personal. 9 times out of 10, it probably is. It doesn't jive. So don't discard it at that, is my point. Everyone follow? Some people jive, some people don't. Secondly, are we taking notes, people? First is confess. Second is repent. If you know in your heart you have missed a defining moment and ignored the chance to make a difference or walked away from a faith or sin, or you should have seized a moment. Simply repent, give it to God, and ask for forgiveness. The difference between saying you're sorry and repenting. If you're doing a repetitive sin, sorry, God. Okay, so I'm sorry, he forgives. God also forgives. Sorry. That's not sorry. Repenting. Lord, I'm so sorry. Please help me change what led to that sin. Behavior that led to that sin, that's repentance. So give with a servant's heart, repent, give it to God, ask for forgiveness, and turn it around. Do something new and let go. Like Jamie did. He packed stuff up, he set his stuff down, in his heart, he gave it up. We read in Romans 7:21-24 that the easiest prey to eat is the one that stands still. And parking in the shadow of your past is the surest way to get caught standing still. People, if you get nothing outside of today, but you got to get out of your past. You got to let it go.
designed me. I'm here for greatness. You designed me for greatness. What is that? What are you planning for? What am I to do? When you start finding out what God's plan is for you, it gets exciting. And sometimes you start finding out that God has a plan for you, you had no idea. Some of the stuff he has you doing, you would have never done in a million years. It's exciting. Remember, that's what your past will do. It'll keep you down. Keep moving and living for today. The more you move, the more you're jamming, the less depth is going to mess. Because it's the less you're allowing it to mess. Don't let history define your future. In fact, we have history in order to rewrite the future. Right? If you have made mistakes, done the wrong thing, missed moments Jesus was holding out for a grab and seize, move on. He's got plenty more. He's got a dream for you. He's got focus for you. Old things are gone and new is here. Embrace it. Now next week, we're going to be talking about exactly how to do that. How to embrace it. How to own it. Okay? So my prayer this week is this. Let's pray. My prayer this week is that when we do the wrong thing, we're not beating ourselves up, Father God. We know you're there. We know you love us unconditionally, like you do. We know you're the King of Kings, and we know that we just need to turn it over to Jesus. Well, we heard comments like that our past has defined some of us, Father God. Some of us are products of our past, but we all are. But again, some of us define us. Some of us have walls put up because of our past. Some of us were brought up differently in churches. Lord, how do we let go and let serve? How do we let go of the pain we have from some of the walls we put up? How do we break those walls? Lord, we love you, God. In Romans, Lord, you told us you discovered the principle of life. We want to do what's right and never really do what's wrong. We love you, Lord. We love your power. Lord, help us. Help us release. Help us let go and let God. In Jesus' name, we all pray.
This morning, we had a Bible study. And, you know, we prepare for things and we have expectations, and today, oh, sorry.
I may have been here.
It's probably not a bad thing. Everybody ready? Well, we're saying that, you know, we get a rhythm now, we have expectations, and Janet and I were coming to prepare for a Bible study, but we kind of got jumped out of ours and into Chris's, and there was a scripture that we read this morning. It's Colossians chapter 1, it's verses 13 and 14, and it's pertinent to our communion today. You know, one of the Bible study members was expressing that they wish they knew the Bible better. The Bible is, depending on which you know, chapter version you have, it might be 2 or 3 inches thick. But there's a lifetime of learning in it. There's always something new and fresh. And every time you get in it, it's almost that you always see something new. And sure enough, these scriptures popped out right off the page to me. Colossians 1, 13, 14 says, "He has delivered us from the power of darkness and conveyed," this is King James Version, "and conveyed us into the kingdom of the Son of His love." Verse 14, "in whom we have redemption through His blood for the forgiveness of sin." And it was that scripture that told me that He has conveyed us out of the darkness into the light of the love of His Son. Conveyed, you know, when you look at a factory, you have a conveyor. And every time something moves along that conveyor, something's added to it, and it's made better, and it's made better, and it's filled, and it's painted, and it's... There are different things that happen depending on what product it is as it moves along that conveyor.
is being prepared for its final purpose. And so, in communion, Christ gave us his body. And this scripture says that he's put us out of the darkness. He's conveyed us out of the darkness into the light of the love of his Son. And the love of his Son has covered all of us. He has put that perfect spirit in you. It resides in you. That's the only perfect part about you, is that spirit that he set in you. And he's conveying us, he's drawing us along out of the darkness into that light, that perfect light of the Son. And in the Last Supper, he held up the bread. He held up the bread, the representation of his body, the conveyance of his body to us. And he broke that bread, signifying the brokenness of this world, to be given to us. And he's asking us to partake in that body, to share that body, to be conveyed out of that darkness into the light. And further, he held up the cup and he said, "This is my blood." And as it said in that scripture, it's the redemption, it's the covering for the forgiveness of sin. And yes, we thank you, Lord Jesus, for your blood and your body, Father God, that draws us into the family. And as the verses were up there, it says, do you trust him? Do you love him? Do you want him? Trust comes from that relationship. You know, we say stranger danger. But when we have a relationship with somebody, we start to trust them. Jen and I have been married for 30 years. And we've got more trust today than we did the day we met. So we can all see that trust comes through a relationship. And that relationship becomes sustaining when you learn how to forgive, which brings us to the second line, because do you love him? Where does love come from but finding forgiveness and humility? And then thirdly, it went down to, do you want him? Well, want is really simply a desire. And so once you start to build the trust in the love, there's nothing but a flood of desire. So those things were very pertinent to this day. But let us share for you the body of Christ.
Thank you.
My prayer today is that we quit standing still. What do you think? I think if we can get anything out of this, we've got that standing still allows Satan to get busy. We don't want him busy, right? In fact, in Jesus' name, we bind you safe from all of us, our ministries, our families, our extended families. Father God, we just pray today, right now, right here, that the Holy Spirit come. Holy Spirit come. Fill us, fill our hearts, fill our homes, fill our cars, fill everything. Lord, be with Terry and Diane and family. Just be with them, cover them with a hedge of protection. Be with Lori and Bruce as they travel back from Florida starting tonight. Protect them. Be with Josh and he feels better as well. Lord, be with people that are hurting today. Say, get out of their way. Don't get hungry somewhere else. Lord, open people's hearts today to communicate with you, even if it's arrow shooting prayers right now. Just so they get the tingle to talk to you and trust you. In Jesus' name, we ask for all of us. Let's stand and make some good noise to get out of here. What do you say? Let it rise. Let's rise and let it rise.